David Dixon once said, "Always expect the unexpected. The oil and gas industry is terrible at predicting anything. Always have a backup plan." Keep this in mind as we discuss today the impact of geopolitics on oil prices. My name is Dr. David Walaloo.
And my name is Dr. Ross Stewart.
And you are watching Geopolitics in Conflict.
If you've been to the gas pump filling up your car recently, you can be pleasantly surprised at the price at the pump, compared to, say, 3 or 4 years ago when it was more than double what it is today. We hope to take some of the mystery out of that and give you some prediction as to what's going to happen to gas prices internationally in the next few years.
Well, that's correct, Ross. Geopolitics appears to play a major role in influencing oil prices around the world. Whether you are a member of an OPEC, the OPEC organization or not, still that question of the supply and demand plays a major role into the prices we're seeing at the gas pump when we go fill up our tank.
Maybe we can take some of the complication out of this and make it understandable. Let's start with our favorite topic,
China. That's correct. And why China is important into all this? Of course, China always have to come up now when it comes down to discussing the economy, regardless. Why? Because China's presence on the global economy cannot be ignored. It's no different than when we talk about the oil industry. And the reason being because, for example, the International Energy Agency has predicted, based on its statistical models, that China will require about 16, up to 16 million barrels a day by 2030.
That's a lot of oil.
Well, it is a lot, but also because China's planes are flying in, people are driving, people are flying inside China, because China has recovered from this COVID-19 pandemic. So the demand for oil is a necessity for them, but also to sustain their economic growth. As they move along with the BRI, the Belt and Road Initiatives, all those projects require access to energy sources from different places.
You know, we might start with the Arctic.
Oh, that's adding to the equation for China's big plan for this energy consumption. And why is that? As we mentioned in one of our shows before, that there are about $35 trillion of untapped oil and natural gas in the Arctic. And you can just see why China's being involved in those projects with Russia, because my prediction is that pipelines will be built from the Arctic all the way down into China, transferring the natural gas and oil.
Well, we already see that happening to some degree, and we see enormous investment from China into that project.
That's correct. China has invested almost up to $900 billion thus far.
And that's not the only part of the plan that China has. We can also take a look at what they've done in Iran.
You're absolutely correct, Russ, and I'm glad you brought this up. Well, I'm sure the recent economic trade between Iran and China of the $400 billion, in which China is going to provide the assistance with the economic infrastructure for Iran and in return for discounted oil. So you can just see why the demand, at least from China, it's still going to be strong enough for it not only to sustain its economy, but also to put that extra oil into the strategic reserves.
You know, we might also just add something about what's going on in Saudi Arabia and China.
Oh, that's another key point. Given Saudi Arabia is the leading player in the OPEC, and just you might know what I'm talking about here. OPEC is the oil producing exporting countries, It's a cartel, if you will, of countries, the top producers of oil, including Saudi Arabia, Iran, Iraq, Kuwait, Angola, Venezuela, and so forth. All those play a role. However, Saudi Arabia does have major control on that organization because the amount of oil it produces. So they can influence their way in making other countries subservient to their demands, if you will. Now, sometimes Saudi Arabia butted heads with Iran regarding oil prices, but of recent, OPEC is losing its relevancy, if you will, or influence on the global market.
Well, each one of these producers is characteristically taking care of themselves first. And as I understand it, Russia is not part of OPEC.
No, it's not. Even Russia is considered the second most oil producers in the world, and they decided not to join OPEC for a reason. So they won't be a subject to the demands by the organization into how much they can put into the market. And this was relevant, and it came up, it was evident during the recent OPEC meeting in June, in which Saudi Arabia and Russia, as a non-member of the OPEC who attended the meeting, the OPEC Plus, what they call it, that both countries decided not to cut down their production. And what that led to? It led to a price war between Saudi Arabia and Russia. And the argument at the time was that analysts, the oil industry analysts, were suggesting that Russia is going to be the loser into this price war. They were wrong. It turns out to be Saudi Arabia that lost more so than Russia. Why? Because Russia has a second source of income, if you will, that is very, very lucrative, which is natural gas. I'm sure you're aware, and you are aware also of the Streamline 2, the pipeline that's coming from Russia into Germany that has to do with the natural gas. So Russia has another source. And that's why, at the end, it turns out to be Saudi Arabia was impacted more so than Russia did.
You know, we might consider the cost of production from the major oil producers.
Well, that is a factor into all this, when you take that into consideration. And what we mean by this is the cost is how much does it cost for countries to produce one barrel of oil? Well, for example, Saudi Arabia, it costs $10 to produce one barrel of oil. Russia, it cost about $25 to produce a barrel. In the United States, it cost about $50 to produce one barrel. So you can just see why, if prices of oil goes down, then there will be no profit for those who produce oil above $15 a barrel, like Russia and the United States. Now, Saudi Arabia, even the cost is cheaper to produce a barrel of oil, it still lost so much money because a couple of years ago, oil prices were at about $115, $112 to $115 a barrel. I argued back then, Ross, back that was 2015 in one of my articles, that we are not going to be seeing prices going up anytime soon. And what I meant by anytime soon is in a reference to the next decade or so. And this is exactly where we are. So, when you go to the gas pump and fill up your car, rest assured that the low prices is not because of Washington or politicians. They're looking for our interest. It's not. It's geopolitics that are impacting the oil prices, even here at home.
You know, you might consider the lobbyists who are working for Saudi Arabia and our Congress.
Well, that is very, very problematic. And what's problematic even more about it is that majority of us, American consumers, have no idea what's going on behind the scenes. Well, what's behind the scenes are lobbyists who are pushing the agenda to ensure that the United States stay dependent on the oil from Saudi Arabia. And I'll give you just one example. Saudi Arabia recently, when I was doing my research for my Iran book, Saudi Arabia went ahead and built a brand new refinery in China.
At a great cost,
that's correct. But refused to update the infrastructure in Houston, where we have the oil reserves. And why is that?
So we'd continue to need their sweet oil with a lot fewer irregularities in the oil.
That's
contaminants.
Correct. That's correct, Russ. And that is the... So politicians in Washington, D.C. are not looking out for our interest, per se, when it comes down to oil prices. It's because the lobbyists are trying to sort of push the agenda for the Saudis, for the United States to stay dependent on the Saudi oil. But also we need to add one thing that our viewers need to know is that the oil in the U.S., the reason why it costs $50 a barrel is because our oil is not sweet, which means it needs a lot of refinement. This is the reason why the argument is it might be better to go and purchase oil from Saudi Arabia than produce it here in the United States.
Two-part question. What would you say is the going to be the impact of this on the American consumer? The second is going to be on American manufacturing. So start with consumers.
Well, it is a good news for the consumers because who does not want to have oil prices very low? I mean, do we want to pay $4 a gallon at the pump? I don't think so. So it is a good news for the consumers if those prices stay low. It is bad news for the industry, of course.
For the oil, for the petroleum
especially
industry,
especially the petroleum,
especially the shale oil.
But also, you add the airline industry, you add the travel industry.
So we're really looking at planes, trains, and cars. Fuel is going to be remarkably cheap for the indefinite future.
That is correct. So that's the good news.
Good for consumers.
Good for consumers.
What about manufacturing in this country in terms of energy costs?
Well, it was going to cost them a lot. I mean, we're not even talking about the oil industry here in the U.S. because they have suffered a lot. There was about over a million loss of jobs.
In the petroleum industry,
That's correct. But also because the cost associated with it.
Right.
And the oil, American oil, is not sold in the market as openly as it is from Saudi Arabia or whatever. I do hope, I was always hoping that China will be purchasing the U.S. oil.
Isn't going to happen when they can get it for $10 or $25 a barrel as opposed to $50 plus.
That's correct. And when you take the trade into the equation, you can see why China's going to bypass the U.S. market as far as importing oil from here and goes with Iran, Saudi Arabia, and Russia.
Here's the bottom line. You might be getting advice as to invest in the oil industry. You might reconsider that in light of the information we've just shared with you. Also, you can consider that transportation is going to continue to be a lot less costly than it has been in the past. And we hope this information has been useful to you.
Well, as always, stay informed. Until next time. Bye-bye.